Okay, good evening, everyone. I'm Alistair Donald. I'm the Associate Director at the Institute of Ideas and also the co-founder of New Narratives, which was a think tank set up to explore the creative sector after Brexit. I'd like to welcome you all to this, which is the first of a series of events that's going to take place over the next 3 months, a series called Democracy in the Arts in Europe. The series has been created by the Institute of Ideas Arts and Society Forum, working with Invoke Democracy Now. And they've done, you know, done a lot of thinking into the three sessions that are going to happen. And the intention behind this series has been really to start to develop some answers as to how we being kind of broadly defined as artists, creatives, people from the cultural sector and the kind of general public audience for arts, how we can respond to the challenge, but I think also quite importantly the opportunity of developing a new relationship to Europe and indeed the wider world. I'll introduce my panel of speakers in a minute, but first of all, just to try and give a little bit of context to the discussion tonight, which is artists in a global world. As everyone undoubtedly knows, tomorrow the Prime Minister will send a letter to the European Union that'll trigger Article 50 and kickstart a two-year period when, as a country, we have to start figuring out what the arrangements are going to be as we come out of the European Union. And you know, no doubt, there's kind of many big and quite practical problems. From orchestras that might want to relocate away from the UK, as we've heard about over the past few months, the paperwork that's needed for bands who want to tour throughout Europe, the implications for theatres or opera houses who want to have understudies come from abroad at short notice and are faced with kind of quite complex visa arrangements. And I don't really want to minimise any of those potential problems, because they undoubtedly are big, important issues that we've got to deal with, but nor do I think that we should necessarily rush to pessimistic conclusions as to how that might work out. But the thing I do really want to emphasise for the purposes of tonight, and this is really kind of the premise of this discussion, is that I think we also have an opportunity to initiate a much wider debate, one that really seeks to take advantage of this need to recreate our relationship with Europe and to use it as an opportunity to, in a sense, rethink everything that we do, to use it as a springboard for creating a new kind of cultural climate of critical opinion, one that, you know, potentially, hopefully, could help transform the creative and cultural sectors. As Grayson Perry said at the end of last year, the challenge is to make Brexit into a fantastic opportunity to challenge the same old comfortable ideas that have been around for a while. So I do want to emphasise that sense of opportunity, as well as the practical issues that I think we have to deal with in terms of how to respond to things like potentially new immigration controls. I think we can kind of look more widely as well at the level of ideas about what is the place of the British cultural and creative sectors in context of Europe and the entire world, for that matter. You know, we've called it artists in the global world, but it's worth, I think, asking what that actually means. Global arts has been a phrase that's been bandied about for 20, 30 years now, but it does, you know, it does seem actually worthwhile interrogating it. If as the government has said, we do want to create a truly global Britain, is that a useful ambition for the arts sector as well? And if so, how can we actually do that? But equally, I think coming from a different perspective, some commentators have been arguing that the global arts has been to the detriment of local and national art scenes. Certainly in the era of kind of globe-trotting curators and artists and directors and of international biennales and so on and so forth, there does seem to have been, to some extent, a detachment of local and national scenes from the global arts world. So I do think it's an opportunity for our panel and for you as an audience to ask some questions about what that actually means and try to get to grips with that. So no doubt, you know, many questions there. No doubt you've all got questions as well. I do think that the spirit that we should come to this talk is one of trying to essentially move beyond the past period of and the kind of rigid divisions between Remain and Brexit, and to actually be a bit more future facing about this debate. Hopefully we can have a fairly open, uninhibited debate about where we are and where it is that we want to go. So let me introduce our panel that are going to kick us off in this discussion, and I'll introduce them in the order that they're going to speak in. So on my far left, first up is Joe Glanville, who's the director of English Pen. Many of you know a charity that defends freedom of expression and promotes literature. Joe was the award-winning editor of Index on Censorship and is a former BBC Current Affairs producer and written for a number of publications that you'd be familiar with. On my immediate left, Sarah Peace, a Nigerian-born writer and artist who works, whose work centres on human rights and conflict, freedom of thought, conscience and expression. Her practice extends across various different art forms, film, photography, installation and performance, and she's exhibited in London and also her second home, Lagos. So kind of interesting cross-country work that you do. Third, second from my right, is Mark Ball. Mark's the outgoing artistic director, CEO of London International Festival of Theatre, where he's been for the last 8 years or so, and he's becoming Associate Artistic Director at Manchester International Festival, focusing on the creation and delivery of the programme at the factory, the new, not even yet started to be built, building in Manchester, which is kind of flagship space for the arts in the future. Fourth up, on my immediate right, Manik Govinda, Head of Arts, Artist Advisory Services, and a producer at Arts Admin, and also, I think importantly for this discussion, convener of the Manifesto Club's Visiting Artists campaign. He writes extensively on freedom of movement and free expression within the arts, and he's asked me to emphasise that he's speaking in a personal capacity tonight rather than representing any of those organisations. And finally, on the far right, Munira Mirza, an advisor on arts and philanthropy, also extensive writer. Many of you would be familiar with Munira from her role for 8 years or so, I think, as deputy mayor at the Greater London Authority. And she's worked in a variety of other different organisations as well, Royal Society of Arts, Policy Exchange and Tate, and she's currently on the board at the Royal Opera House. So that's who we've got. The format that we've got tonight, I've given them each of them about 5 to 6 minutes to kick us off with some opening remarks. After that, there'll be plenty of time for them to pick up on things that each other have said. We'll try and keep around half of this discussion for points and contributions from the audience. And we'll bring it to an end with a minute or so for them to each sum up. Without further ado, enough from me. Joe.
Hi, everyone. Just to say, first of all, congratulations to Invoke Democracy Now for their quite remarkable foresight. I knew it was going to be the eve of Brexit. I didn't know it was going to be literally the eve of Brexit. And you've asked us to be future-focused, but I think to be future-focused, I'm going to have to start with, in a sense, the obstacles that there are in order to make that future possible. And PEN, the organisation I work for, as Alistair said, it's got a dual role. It promotes literature, but also defends the human rights that make literature possible, and that is obviously freedom of expression, but increasingly the right to privacy as well. And it's a very old organisation, PEN. It was founded in 1921. John Galsworthy, H.G. Wells were the first people to kick it off. And its charter, the first words of its charter, are literature knows no frontiers. And that's obviously a recognition that books don't need passports, ideas don't need passports, they can travel very freely. But it also obviously has a very literal meaning, and the work that we do has always supported writers, writers who are in trouble, writers who are refugees, helping writers to cross borders. And that goes from Arthur Koestler many, many years ago when he was imprisoned by the fascist regime in Spain to most recently Can Dündar, the Turkish journalist, who's now in exile in Berlin. And we've worked very closely with Manik over the years, campaigning for visas to make it possible for writers to travel. And that has brought some positive changes, new visa schemes, new routes for artists and writers so that they can come and work in the UK or come for short visits to the UK. And visas are for anyone working in the arts, bringing international artists, writers to this country. Visas are a constant hurdle, a constant problem. The red tape, the documentation, are you going to get the visa in time? And with Brexit, where we have no clarity yet for EU citizens who are working here in the arts or for EU artists who may want to come and work here in the future, we are running the risk of choking the arts with red tape and also increasing the expense and therefore the cost of enjoying the arts in this country. And I had a chat with my team today. We're a very small team. There are just six of us. They're all, most of them are very young, under 35, under 30. One of them is from Austria. And just to get a sense of what they felt was important, what was worrying them at the moment. And one of them said to me, a young woman under 30, said to me, Brexit is going to make the arts more elitist in this country because it's just going to become more expensive. People are going to have to put their prices up. It's going to be, if you're going to have to sort of get visas for every artist who visit, that's immediately going to put the cost up, never mind the bureaucratic difficulty. So what seems to me absolutely crucial at this moment is a very, very urgent discussion between the arts community and governments, the Home Office, UKVI, for what kind of visa regime are we going to have? And there's got to be some real imagination and vision and courage about that. But it's really urgent, and in fact, it's already overdue. But it obviously doesn't just concern the arts, although that's what we're focusing on tonight. We are at the risk of a real brain drain across the UK. And 2 weeks ago, it was London Book Fair. We always have a big platform. We do lots of events with writers and with writers visiting. This year, it was writers visiting from Poland. And my member of staff, who is from Austria, she told me that she met around 20 colleagues at London Book Fair, all from, you know, across the EU. The first question they asked each other was, how are you? The second question was, are you going to stay? And only two out of the 20 said, yes, I'm going to stay. And that's obviously just one anecdote, but quite a shocking anecdote. And I think that for this member of staff, who her story is obviously repeated across the country, this is a time of great anxiety, great uncertainty, and the personal and emotional cost is and has been unnecessary. The consequences for the UK and for the arts potentially are calamitous because of the skills and the talent we're going to lose. The other side of this, from my perspective, is about human rights, which obviously, if freedom of expression, if creativity, if creative expression is going to thrive, you've got to have the right environment and culture for that, and that means you've got to defend the space for freedom of expression. Now, for me, in terms of our campaigning, we campaign here, wherever freedom of expression is at risk, around writing, journalism, and we have campaigns overseas as well. I am no longer going to be able to use the EU as a forum for campaigning. I've already had to make a very difficult decision, which is to stop a campaign that was already breaking new ground to repeal criminal defamation across the EU. The UK is one of the only very few countries in the EU that repealed criminal defamation laws, which means you get a criminal record or go to prison if you're sued for libel. So I'm having to abandon that. And looking further ahead, we know very well that Theresa May has made her antipathy and hostility towards the European Convention on Human Rights very clear, and that once Brexit is out of the way, assuming that isn't going to take 30 years, she's then going to move on to the European Convention on Human Rights, which is a very serious potential threat to our human rights, not just freedom of expression. And many of the most important landmark cases over the last 50 years have been settled in the European Court of Human Rights. One really landmark case is the protection of journalists' sources, which had to be be taken to Strasbourg because it lost in every court in this country. The case was successful, and as a result, journalists have very, very important protection for their sources. So from my perspective, I fear that we're not looking at the truly global Britain that Theresa May apparently aspires to, that what we might be looking at is a shrinking Britain with less clout on the world stage, less able to protect creativity and the rights that make it possible, and deprived of the talent and the skills that we need.
Okay, thank you very much. Could we give her a quick round of applause? Right, so I think that's some very useful stuff that you've raised there to be getting on with. Sarah, do you want to give us your thoughts?
All right, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here, I'm going to speak a little bit faster than I would have liked it, because there's so much to say and so little time. But I'm here in the capacity of an artist whose position differs from the 96% who favoured Remain, and whose perspectives haven't really been heard. I considered that going public about voting Brexit would adversely affect my career, but then I remembered that I didn't have much of a career anyway. I mean, how many of you had heard of me before tonight? Exactly. That said, my openness about my position could still potentially come at a cost. I do have approved Arts Council funding that's been approved but hasn't been spent. That may well now hang in the balance. My contribution to the debates may depict me as turkey voting for Christmas or chicken campaigning for KFC. After all, I myself am a beneficiary of globalization. But it gets worse, as I'm additionally guilty of heresy on two counts, being a Brexiteer and being a Conservative Party member. But apart from observing the daily morning Tory ritual of eating babies for breakfast, I promise I'm innocent. I stand by my Leave vote, not because I'm oblivious or immune to the purported rise in hate crime, but because I choose, like many others, to observe and experience the world around me rather than live it through an ideological frame that preempts division, aggression, inequality, and discrimination in society. But getting back to the matter at hand, which we're here tonight to discuss, about how artists are operating in this climate of disagreement, dissensus, and polarity. If we take anything away from the aftermath of the Brexit vote, two narratives emerge. One in which the Western world is becoming increasingly hostile to minorities and calls for organization and solidarity as a response. However, social solidarity has become defined not by politics, but by ethnicity, faith, gender, sexuality. And rather than ask, what kind of society do I want to live in? People now ask, well, who am I and who best represents me? On the other hand, we have another narrative which shows that people who are on the receiving end of all of the rhetoric presented by the first group, which is responsible for the production of culture, comprises of people who for a long time have been politically voiceless and have expressed concerns but somehow are seen as part of the problem. Art is intrinsic to this dissensus because the mode in which difference is expressed is hugely important because it frames the way in which politics is understood and in turn how voters respond. In order to answer the Brexit question in relation to artistic and cultural production, in light of how this impacts society and democracy, we're led to look closer at the government's position. Theresa May's Brexit position for a global Britain reaches far beyond Europe, and in my view, it is one that represents a wealth of new prospects for art practitioners from all around the world. The discourse of creative practice and Brexit cannot really be separate to wider political discourse because artists, for the most part, have responded in line with the first narrative I outlined. Most of the noise has been a complete misreading of the situation, a deliberate attempt to misread what the public is saying and what the people want. The media has done a disservice to the people in suggesting that the British people on the whole, are opposed to immigration, but in reality, they have specific concerns about the volume, the pace, and specifically about immigration from theocratic regimes. Theresa May's global proposition is one in which Britain thrives by remaining open to international talent. It is not closing the door on Europe. Rather, it creates a level playing field which attracts talent from all over the world. The Prime Minister noted that the EU has struggled to deal with diversity amongst member countries, bending towards uniformity and not flexibility. In the same way, the art bends towards uniformity and not diversity, in relation to identity, but not diversity of thought. In the same way that the mainstream media has maligned Brexiteers as unreasonable, to put it mildly, artists have largely done the same. In fact, artists have facilitated a lot of that process with strong oppositional visual campaigns. In order to answer the question of how artists might engage with regional and national identities, well, if the recent events are anything to go by, I think we will see even less engagement with national identity because the art world is heavily invested in the same ideology that drives the loudest activist voices. By that, I mean the undercurrents or rhetoric around refugees welcome, F your borders, and which is largely driven by, in my view, a disdain for the West. It is our moral duty to provide refuge to those who need it, surely, but we have to recognize that there is a growing disdain for the West, for Britain, an embarrassment about British history, which informs how people frame flag-flying, nationalism, and immigration. This outlines how it has become so easy to paint concerns about immigration as equivalent to racism.
Okay, thanks very much. So kind of, I suppose, quite strikingly different take on it there. So we can come back to that and explore that a little. But Mark, do you want to give us your thoughts?
Sure, and I'm aware you asked us to be optimistic, and apologies if I come across as the House pessimist. But I do genuinely want the best for British artists and arts organisations. And you're absolutely right that there's no point in rerunning the arguments around the referendum. We remain as lost, and we have to accept that democratic mandate for Brexit. It's happening. So with that plucky British spirit we're all famed for, we have to get on with it and make it work, right? Well, I'm afraid I'm not terribly optimistic, as I said, Alistair, about that it's going to be as easy as some of my Brexiteers friends claim. I don't speak for all of the arts. I work in international theatre and performance. At Lift, we bring international theatre from all over the world to London. And I know that other sectors, such as the visual arts, operate very differently and often in a globalised art market. But in the world I operate in, Europe is a very significant marketplace. Many of our leading theatre companies like Complicité or Force Entertainment have become such heavyweight artistic forces because of European production investment. Our contemporary dance companies earn their living across Europe. For Lift, our second largest funder is the EU via the Creative Europe programme. It enables us to bring work to London stages and to support artists through co-production. And even a recent conservative estimate by the organisation Euclid is that investment from the EU over the last 10 years into arts, culture, media, heritage and creative industries has been €1 billion. As a nation, we trade twice as much with Ireland as we do with China, twice as much with Belgium as we do with India, three times as much with Sweden as we do with Brazil. One of the real joys of my job is that I get to travel across Europe and the world, talking to artists, to producers, and leaders of cultural organisations. And since June the 23rd, the tone of the conversations that I've had have changed pretty drastically with those artists and organisations who tell me that they're worried about Brexit. They saw a campaign dominated, actually, by immigration. That was the perception. They think it sent out a signal that the UK is in retreat, is less welcoming to artists from around the world. And as an aside, I've also witnessed the government's ridiculously bombastic Great campaign being ridiculed by international artists and players since the referendum. So as you said, Alistair, we've already seen the possibility of orchestral talent drain out of the UK as European orchestras relocate to Europe. And already artists that Lyft has been talking to, we've started conversations with, the projects in Lyft 2020, some of those artists have decided not to pursue their ideas for projects in the UK because they're worried about the potential plethora of visas, work permits and carnets that might exist in the pro-Brexit Britain. This is completely unscientific, but in preparation for this, I carried out a straw poll of the 40 European arts organisations that we work with regularly on an ongoing basis, and 70% of them told me that they were less inclined to work with British artists and organisations post-Brexit. Now, I'm not claiming that's representative, but it was quite startling. Because Europe for them is not just a market, it's about the will to live and work and create together. For them, we're not leaving a market, we're leaving a shared dream. But Theresa May's new bold vision for Britain is of an outward-facing country, forging new international alliances way beyond Europe. And with the right conditions, I'm sure that's not impossible, but it's going to be tremendously hard work. And that it's being painted as a series of easy wins by the Brexiteers, I think, is a bit delusional. They seem to have a vaguely defined notion that somehow Britain might reassemble chosen fragments of empire. And it's telling that a couple of weeks ago, that it was reported in the media that Whitehall officials have described Britain's plans for post-Brexit, have described the plans for Britain's post-Brexit trading relationship with the Commonwealth as Empire 2.0. As the writer and broadcaster David Olasaga recently said, our newfound Brexit focus on the Commonwealth feels uncomfortably akin to recent divorcees looking up their former partners on Facebook and being shocked to discover that they've got married, had kids and moved on. They might have fond memories, they might even want to be on good terms, but they don't really miss us. Former colonies, like old flames, build new relationships based on their own needs and ambitions. And I've witnessed that at first hand too. Recently we've been working in Nigeria in the Lagos Theatre Festival, where you can see years of hard work and cultural investment by the French Institute and the Goethe Institute have seized the cultural initiative there. It's with those countries that many West African artists are now wanting to form relationships with. And geography matters too. Canada has undoubted links to the UK, but it has a 5,000-mile border with the US, their key trading partner. Australia and New Zealand have strong emotional and cultural links to Britain. But as the economies of Asia have boomed, Australian and New Zealand artists and organisations now look to Asia for cultural exchange and partnership. Australia's by far most important festival this year was the Asiatopia Festival in Melbourne. Companies that we work with from Japan came to the UK because they saw the UK as a jumping-off point for Europe. They're now abandoning their plans to come to Europe and to come to the UK and just go straight to Europe. Everywhere I go, I also notice that we Brits tend to operate in a very transactional way, and Brexit really typifies that for me. Everything is about the deal. It's about the new trade deal. It's about what we can get. Yet nothing in the language that I hear seems to be about shared values, the ideas and dreams, the very things that underpin culture. To come back to your question, Alistair, will Brexit create a strong sense of localism in our cultural life, something that's been lost by the forces of globalisation? Maybe. But we must also recognise that the local and the global have and are always umbilically linked. Lyft is currently developing a theatre project in Great Yarmouth, a town that voted overwhelmingly for Brexit, working with members of the 10,000-strong Portuguese community there. All economic migrants needed to work in the town's poultry industry. You can't separate the local from the international. So I'm not full, I'm afraid, of the fervent faith of my fellow Brexiteers that we're on the dawn of a glorious new future, but I also know that we can't retreat into pessimism. And Joe's absolutely right. We need to lobby for easier movement of artists around the world. We need to lobby for that €1 billion black hole in EU funding. And we need a British approach, that's a bit more humble, that's less transactional, and that's built on our values and ideas rather than just money.
Okay, thanks very much, Mark. Not so sure I was asking people to be optimistic as to think about whether there was opportunities. I think there's a difference. It's not an enforced optimism about this. Manik.
Okay, well, I'm going to sound naively utopian, I think, because I actually do believe, and I do think that universal freedom of movement is morally a very good ideal to strive for. The idea of living in a world of open borders is a beautiful idea, and we should argue for open borders and strive for it. Before World War I, the the planet lived, we lived in a world with barely any border restrictions across the globe, aside from, you know, sort of tyrannical countries like Tsarist Russia and the Ottoman Empire. You know, there was freedom of movement. There were no need for passports, visas, or work permits or other form of paperwork. So I would like to dream and make that kind of reality of such a world real again. But then we had the two world wars, and the collapse of Western empires changed all of that. So fundamentally, my reason for opposing the EU is because this is an apparatus that fundamentally restricts freedom of movement for non-EU citizens. The EU has created a fortress Europe. It means that people who live in the former colonies of the European nations, France, Belgium, Germany, Great Britain, they have no right to freedom of movement within the European Union. And furthermore, EU freedom of movement does not extend to people who live in the outer European overseas territories. So countries, French territories such as Martinique, La Réunion, French Guyana, Guadeloupe, and many other overseas countries who are part of the Euro economy and are part of the European Union. Their citizens have an EU passport, but they do not have freedom of movement in mainland Europe. So freedom of movement within the EU member states only applies to continental Europe, not its overseas territories. With so many border controls, the arts therefore must be the imaginary realm where borders should not apply. And that doesn't mean that nations are to be eroded or homogenized into super states. Open borders are different from no borders, in that the former recognizes independent countries with its own government and people who are citizens of a country. And many of those countries fought for or struggled against European empires for freedom and self-determination through uprisings and revolutions. Now, artists and writers have always been at the forefront in struggles against colonial rule. So it really does surprise me that a vast majority of artists in the UK wish to submit to EU rule over independence and national self-determination. So what's to be done? I think that leaving the EU is a transgressive, rebellious force that artists really should embrace, as it frees the artist from performing to an ideologically driven bureaucracy and connects him or her to more closely to a democratic public. Liberated from the European Union, the artists would be free to shed light into the human condition as citizens of the very country that they were born in, live in, or have moved to. The human condition is not only the territory of suffering, conflict, and pain, but it's also about the beauty of people, human beings, and the stories of our towns, cities, and countryside, and the people who live there, our fellow citizens. So we need to look beyond the EU narrative of a forced, artificially constructed, top-down Europeanism. The UK probably has more in common with South Korea than with Slovenia or Slovakia. So let's look further afield. The UK needs to strengthen its relationships with its English-speaking nations. It's no accident that artists, directors, poets, and writers like David Hockney, Salman Rushdie, the late David Bowie, Harry Kunzru, Alfred Hitchcock, W.H. Auden, they all moved to the USA. It's no accident that my 16-year-old niece is obsessed by Korean pop, and that the British Council and the Arts Council are putting in significant funds into supporting UK and South Korean artistic collaborations and cultural exchange. It's no accident that some of our best writers in the world originate from the Caribbean, West Africa, and the Indian subcontinent, and their genius is built from deep relationships, not from the forced arranged marriages within the EU member states. As Article 50 is triggered, immigration is, of course, at the forefront of everyone's mind. And, of course, I absolutely believe that the nationals of the current European Union member states have the right to remain in the UK and to work in the UK. And it's important that we campaign for their rights to remain if they have set down roots or have built deep relationships with people in the UK. But we do need to think bigger. Increased movement and reciprocal relationships with other countries. So why not Korea, India, Ghana, Kenya, New Zealand, Australia, the Caribbean, or the USA? The European Union is in a crisis as a supranational state. It's time to let it crumble, and only then can we build fuller and more authentic relationships with European countries and many other nations of the world. So let's reimagine and rebuild a world of independent nations with welcoming open doors again. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so we can suss out whether you're utopian or not when it comes to the discussion, but Manira.
Thank you. Like my fellow panellists from ethnic minority backgrounds, I too voted for Brexit, which must be cognitive dissonance for so many people, because most people assume on the... a lot of people assume that if you voted for Brexit, you must be somehow racist or in favour of a whites-only country or opposed to ethnic minorities. And actually, what's interesting is that 1 million people in this country from ethnic minority backgrounds voted for Brexit. A third of the total ethnic population of voters voted for Brexit. So already, I think, there are ways to challenge the narrative that people who voted to leave are racist and xenophobic. And I think we have to address that fact. That's how they have been presented. And I think that's deeply unfortunate. I voted for Brexit, but I also am very positive about immigration. I worked in London government for 8 years, and I can see that immigration has brought enormous benefits both to London and to the rest of the country. It brings new talent, new ideas. For the arts, it's especially important. It's one of the things that has made London a fantastic city to live in. I'm extremely positive about those benefits. I'm very positive as well that there are times in a country's life where large-scale immigration, mass migration, is a very good thing. If you look at the history of the UK, if you look at countries like Israel and Australia, they celebrate immigration. They want larger numbers. For them, it's a very positive thing. But the question that we're being asked to discuss tonight is a specific form of immigration policy, which is freedom of movement. And people often assume that freedom of movement is just the same thing as immigration. And if you are opposed to freedom of movement, you must also be opposed to immigration. And that is far too simplistic a way of understanding this area of policy. I have concerns about freedom of movement, and I'd like to talk through these concerns. And I think it's far too simplistic to talk about freedom of movement as simply the only way in which you can manage immigration in this country, which is liberal and humane and fair for people who are coming in. I used to actually sympathise very much with Manik's position of open borders, and I can see the idealistic attraction of it, because obviously migration brings huge benefits for a country, but also for the migrants themselves. My family are migrants, and I've seen in my own personal experience how important that is. But my position on free movement has changed in the last few years, because I do think that there is a need for border controls. And you could take a position like Manik, which is that there is no need at all for border controls. I think that's the position you've argued. I may be wrong, so apologies if I've characterised your position incorrectly. But I do think that there is a need for borders, and I do think that a nation state has the right to protect its borders and to decide and control those borders according to the will of its people. And so my concerns about free movement are in three main areas. The first is that the free movement of the EU took away the democratic control of the people of the UK over who comes into their country. And I do think that for immigration policy to be successful, it needs to have the consent of the people who live in that country. And you could see that the fact that many people felt that they did not have a voice, that their view was not taken seriously, that has caused resentment. Not against migrants, as it happens, I think. Largely, people in Britain are very tolerant and very supportive of immigration, but they're very resentful about the elite that makes decisions about who comes in and doesn't take their opinion seriously. Immigration does have a certain level of numbers and volume and pace. It does have a large impact on this country. It has an impact on infrastructure. It has an impact on population growth and local services. It has an impact on wage levels. And these things have to be considered when you're designing an immigration policy. And the idea that people should just accept numbers growing and the impact on their area without having any say in that, I think, is unrealistic and unreasonable. My second concern about freedom of movement in the context of the EU debate is that freedom of movement is not just about immigration or movement, it's about automatic rights to citizenship. So certain benefits which are usually reserved for people who have citizenship and have a social contract with the state, freedom of movement essentially undermines that and says that the experience and the rights of the people who have been in the country for a very long period of time are the same as somebody who is arriving here without a previous history. I don't think that that is feasible when you're talking about a social contract, when you have a welfare state, when you have a benefit system, when you have an NHS. And there is some resentment about the idea that the people who have paid into the system are not allowed to have a priority or some privilege in that. And then the third point, which Manik has already talked about, and so has Sarah, is that free movement within the EU has been prioritised at the expense of movement from countries outside the EU. And Manik ran a very successful and very important campaign about visiting artists from outside the EU, which when I was at City Hall, we worked with that campaign. The rules that Joe has talked about, the worries about bureaucracy and visas, they already exist in Britain for artists who are outside the EU. So I think this is an incredibly important opportunity to redesign the whole system, to make it much more responsive to the needs of artists, to the needs of academics, to have a different kind of system. I think there are alternatives to free movement, and I've been arguing for something called fluidity of movement, where you do have a system of visas which are specifically for artists. You have short-term work permits. You have a system which allows flexibility of travel. I think these things are not beyond the wit of man. I think we can design a system like that. But we have to, I think, stop discriminating against people who come from outside the EU.
Last minute.
And then, finally, on global Britain, I do think there is an opportunity to redefine ourselves as more internationalist, to recognise that there are other countries outside the EU we want to have a serious relationship with. I understand Mark's pessimism and his fear that people are looking at Britain now and saying, well, you know, they're just a bunch of racists, they just voted to leave the EU. I also think there is a different point of view from countries outside the EU who feel, actually, now we have a chance to do trade deals. We do have a chance to have a fairer immigration policy. And if countries outside the EU and people outside the EU look at Britain and think they're a bunch of racists, maybe that's because our arts sector has encouraged that view and that perception of the UK. And maybe the art sector could reflect on the people that it's criticising, the people who voted to leave, and say, well, maybe it wasn't out of xenophobia or racism, but because they had legitimate concerns, and that we should understand and try and recognise that.
Okay, thank you very much. Right, I just want to very quickly sort of pick up a couple of things before we go out for audience contributions, but I suppose Mark and Joe, do you want to come back on any of the points that the other three have raised? I mean, I suppose this a bit more optimistic interpretation of things, and so especially this point about, and it was made very strongly by Manik and Sarah, about the EU being Fortress Europe, and what the possibilities now are to plug into a wider network of things going on throughout the world. So point of view, actually, Radio 4 a couple of weeks ago was making the point that, you know, why aren't we desperate to get in and join with Africa and Asia, which are kind of in many ways the more dynamic areas of the world just now? So are you not being overly pessimistic? Is there not opportunities here?
Well, not being in favour of Brexit doesn't mean that one does not criticise the EU. You know, I mean, I'm well aware of what all the problems are with the EU, of Fortress Europe. We've seen horrific, and we continue to see horrific scenes of tragedy, of people trying to get to Europe, of the treatment of refugees. You know, you don't have to leave the EU in order to try and address the problems. You know, and also the points that
EU
I was...
The EU is constituted on that fortress-like wall.
Well, you know, we can. The point is that you can try and address the issues while you are within the EU. You can't address them when you leave. But the point that I was making anyway in talking about the work that we did with Manik in visas and in getting effective routes for artists was, you know, obviously absolutely recognising that there are big issues around anyone outside the EU getting into Europe. So the fact is, yes, there are problems, there were problems, but what Mark showed so powerfully is the very serious impact that there is already on the arts and on the future of the arts in this country. And we've got to have a very effective new approach to visas, but this is all happening incredibly late. You know, that the damage is starting to be felt already.
Two quick things. Just firstly, to pick up on Manera's point, I don't think, in my own view, I don't think that people paint people as who voted for Brexit as racist. And I don't think my European colleagues look upon the 17 or 18 million people who voted for Brexit as racist. But it has created an uncomfortable position where they feel more uncertain about their relationship with the UK. They are not going, we're not coming into your country because you're racist. I think, yes, of course there are opportunities, but it's not a binary thing. Arts organisations like Lyft continued, even though we were part of the EU, to strive for relationships globally, to try and form partnerships globally. But, you know, and it's a big but, working in Europe, there's a thing called the Creative Europe Fund. That is a €1 billion investment fund every 4 years that funds film, media, the arts, heritage, all sorts of culture. We have tried endlessly to develop our work, particularly in West Africa, over the past few years, and parts of the Middle East. It's very hard when there is not a history of public investment in the arts in those places, and there is very little resource. You know, there is an inbuilt advantage of being part of Europe in that, you know, 27 countries contribute to a cultural to a cultural fund. So, you know, artists will also go where the money is. I also just picking up on one thing Manik said: the idea that artists somehow make work determined by a kind of European bureaucratic ideology, I find bizarre. They make work they want to make. They make the kind of work they want to make. It can be funded by Europe. It can be funded by the Arts Council. They're not following an Arts Council bureaucratic ideology and doing it.
Okay. So, Manik, do you want to come back on anything Manera says? Sarah and Manera, do you want to address the points that Joe and Mark were making about, you know, that there is a loss of income through grants and so on and so forth. There's a potential kind of retrenchment of some of the ways that the arts can get on. So Manik, you go first and come back in Manera.
Yeah, I mean, just to say that I made a distinction between open borders and no borders. So I don't believe in that kind of anarchic system where, you know, national states and countries are just a blur. So the kind of open door policy is certainly one that you can open and close. So what I would say is that we need to be welcoming, and I think you've certainly expressed that. But the arts certainly, I think, has a special status. Being an artist is not the kind of low or non-skilled blue-collar work that's originally what joining the European Economic Community was supposed to be about, the where there's labour shortages and skills shortages, you can get this influx of labour from Europe. And prior to that, it was obviously the former Commonwealth countries or the colonies. And so what we have now is this replacement, particularly around this kind of skills argument that, we have EU nationals being able to fulfill those skills. We therefore don't need nurses from South Africa or occupational therapists from Australia. So my position is that the arts are something that it is about this ideal, which I was trying to argue about, this passportless ideal. For freedom of movement. I thoroughly believe that if people stay in a certain country, then they should be able to become citizens of that country, and that should be done with as little bureaucracy as possible.
Yeah, sorry, just to clarify a point, I don't believe that there shouldn't be ways of earning citizenship or becoming citizens in a country. You know, absolutely I do. It's just a question of the length of that journey and the automatic nature of citizenship under the EU free movement rules. On the point about Creative Europe and funding, this happened all the time during the campaign. People would talk about huge amounts of money that came from the EU for the art sector. Creative Europe funding in the UK in the year 2014 to 15 was £10 million. Arts Council England funding in that year was £600 million. Government funding in total was over £1 billion. It's a fraction of what the UK government already spends. And my argument during the campaign was that a stronger economy, a more resilient economy, economy that benefits more people, will also be able to support the arts. And I find that sometimes in the art sector, the immediate short-term benefits of the EU, the fear of change, the fear of transitioning to a new arrangement with the rest of the world, tends to blinker the art sector and make it much more conservative than it needs to be. The art sector prides itself on being daring, radical, thinking in a visionary way, having a concern about social justice and communities around the country. And yet on this debate, it seems to have so many blind spots. And I cannot understand how those people who voted to remain, who are arguing against the result now, see themselves as on the side of, and I'm not suggesting that Joe or Mark are doing this, but there are many people out there who still see themselves on the side of a more progressive set of values, and yet argue against the democratic will of people, and see themselves as somehow being at the vanguard of some kind of moral movement that the rest of the population don't understand.
But we all know perfectly well that the reason why we had a referendum was for the around the internal political fighting of the Tory party. That's why the referendum happened. And the Tory party saving itself as a political party because it was losing out to the far right. There is no plan. That is what's so terrifying about this. There literally is no plan. And it's not just about the money that comes from Creative Europe. It's about the money that regenerates, that has regenerated Cornwall, Wales, the massive influx of funding from the EU.
Where do you think that money comes from, Jo?
But it's about...
We are a net contributor to the EU.
Yeah, of course we are. It's about the regulatory framework, all those frameworks around data protection, around intellectual property, the massive amount of work that is going to have to be done to redraw from scratch. And we know that there are not enough civil servants in the government to do it. It's a catastrophe.
Okay. Civil servants is a good time to stop. Right, so questions. I'm going to take them in groups of three or four if I can. I'll come back up to the panel and you can pick up what you want to. So let's start somewhere over here.
Joe is right that freedom of speech is crucial to this debate, but she's looking at the EU with rose-tinted glasses because the European Union has never been a force for freedom of speech, in fact, quite the opposite. So we look at the case, for example, of the German journalist Hans-Martin Tillich of Der Bild, who wrote a whole series of stories exposing massive corruption within the European Commission. The Commission ordered the Belgian police to arrest him, to seize all his computers, which have never been returned. We look at the case of the EU directive, which will make it illegal to question UN-recognised genocides. We look at the case, for example, now of the EU looking to extend the notion of hate crime beyond incitement to violence to offensiveness. And Tony Blair is now touring, for money, of course, the capitals of Europe, drumming up support for a new pan-European law that would massively restrict freedom of speech in line with his act in 2006, which limited what we were allowed to say about religion.
Hang on, let's take a few questions. There's someone else in the front row, and then to the person behind in the fourth row.
Nika MacDonald. I do wonder, I mean, there's a kind of fundamental, rather crass question, is what are the arts for? And there's a debate about how instrumental the arts have become, particularly in the UK, but probably elsewhere. And the proliferation of arts activities and institutions, and yet perhaps not a concomitant increase in enlightenment as a result of that. So I think we need to question what arts is for. And also, arts funding. I almost feel, and perhaps this is a London-centric perspective, there's too much funding for the arts. There's too much to do, too much perhaps low-quality work that isn't attended by enough people and is just subsidised by the bureaucrats we referred to. And as my experience in running a Southwest-based creative industries organisation, I found the whole experience of dealing with Brussels bureaucrats, who we're not allowed to talk about, very demoralising. And I do wonder about, even if we were to have stayed in the EU, we should really be, or the EU should be, reforming the way it funds the arts, because it's a very top-down and antithetical institution for the arts, in my experience.
OK, there's someone on the end of the row, about three or four rows back.
You know, I feel like I've got strong feelings about art, arts, and quite strong feelings about Europe too, but I'm not convinced that they're remotely connected. That was my difficulty with the whole conversation. I know that, I mean, look, I think probably performing arts more than most forms have got a reliant on subsidies, so you have to pay attention to the kind of governance question. That's not really true of writing or even painting in this country. I think, you know, what art do I like? Well, there are people I know like kind of ethnic-y concrete art. I don't, but that, you know, that's their choice. You know, we're going to have more of it, I suppose. What, like with Grayson Perry? I mean, I thought, you know, Peter Blake and Gilbert and George had the kind of ethnic Englishness covered, and that was about enough that I could stomach. But it isn't up to me. But so I, you know, what nationally bounded, what continent bounded, I don't care. What European or American, I love American stuff. I think I probably consume more American culture than I consume any other culture. Not surprisingly, because we're all in the Anglosphere. So, Europe is a great place. It seems a bit fusty and old. But I don't see what loyalty I have as a consumer of art to, you know, Britain, Europe, or any of those places. So it's the mind, you know, it's a republic of letters. So I'm not moved by that. None of this seems to me like about, you know, what I think was probably a good choice was, you know, freedom about deciding that we'll make the laws here. But what it's got to do with the arts, I'm not sure.
Okay.
Right, I've got a question to Mark mainly, but to anyone. I think it's a question about your idea of the local and the local and the global, global as you called it. And you gave the example of work you've been doing in Great Yarmouth with the Portuguese refugees there, or the migrant workers. And I used to teach in Great Yarmouth and Lowestoft, as it happens, and that's it. What you said seems to me a bit of a problem, and it comes up in also the way people are saying, let's extend our relationships to the whole world, not just Europe, which I'm not against. But it does seem to me there's some really important people missing from that. And if you go to Lowestoft or Great Yarmouth, there's a lot of people who aren't Portuguese refugees. They're white, rather blobby, not very attractive looking working class people who work in the peas factory or in the fish and chip shop. And I think it's that kind of constituency that people in the arts have for decades now been really avoiding. And I think, and I wonder whether the whole institutional setup of the EU has been a good mechanism which has made that distancing possible. The distancing that critics of the early part of the 20th century, Leavis or I.A. Richards and all other people who were out there fighting for people like T.S. Eliot to be recognised, okay, they did it through public writing, through trying to reach a much wider audience. Whereas it seems to me the kind of, you know, your idea of the global and the local seems to me quite a technical one. Just putting something in Great Yarmouth doesn't, to me, constitute a kind of local democratic relationship.
Thank you. There's a lady down there. Yes. One of you, quickly.
Okay. Oh, sorry.
And then I'm going to come back to the panel.
We had a class now. You were saying, Manik, and somebody in there about going to the US, and I want to as an alternative, and I don't see how that deals with then voting for Brexit. I want to make an argument about size, because if you think the US or another big country, for example, India, is an alternative, that, yes, of course, but Brexit, the equivalent of Brexit would be as if you need a visa between going from New York to New Jersey or between going from New Delhi to Kerala. It's about size. I mean, if we cut ourselves up into such small units, it doesn't work. It doesn't mean that there aren't any human rights abuses by any government. But if we cut ourselves up, that's not the way how way how to move forward. Okay. We have to campaign for human rights, and therefore we need platforms, as Joe was saying. If we don't have platforms, we can't speak to each other about what's wrong.
All right, thank you. So, panel, do you want to pick up on any of those points? Not more than one. Yeah, Manira, you go.
The country which we... I don't know how best to say this. I want to get it absolutely right. The country which we export the most cultural goods to is the US, more than any other country, by quite a long way. We have a relationship, a healthy relationship with the US culturally. We have exchange with the US. We could improve the visa situation. I hope that we will. But it's possible to do it without being a member of the EU. And the EU is a political structure. It is not the same thing as Europe. Obviously, I want us to continue having a cultural relationship with Europe. I do think it has something to do with the arts and that the possibility of people moving back and forth, the possibility of exchange programs, the subsidy does matter. And I think... we want to encourage artists from different cultures and communities to mix. So I'm in favour of the globalised art world. I'm in favour of more of it, diversity of it. I don't want to see arts funding cut. I want to see it increased. But this idea that the EU is the only way in which we can engage globally and to leave it is putting ourselves in a catastrophic situation where it's impossible now to leave the UK just doesn't make sense to me. It feels too short-sighted and actually driven more by an anxiety and a fear, which I don't think really reflects the art sector. The art sector is actually very diverse and innovative and daring in many ways, and it seems to me that this is a blind spot and we could get over it.
Mark, anything that you want to...
Just to pick up on the Great Yarmouth point, I mean, I broadly agree with what you're saying. I think that, you know, I think one of the... In the 60s and 70s and early 80s, there was an amazing community arts movement in the UK, which has been rubbished because it was seen as poor quality. But it did actually, it did amazing work in communities over a very long period of time in places that didn't get much access to the arts. And maybe one of the things that we should be thinking about in the recalibration around our relationships and what Brexit might mean and what that, and the disruption that might mean is to also think, and I accept this is a problem with the arts. A lot of the people who voted for Brexit are people who are not engaged with the arts. It's been a failure of arts organisations to really truly engage with many people in their communities. And that is a responsibility as us, as people running arts organisations, and we have to try and reconfigure that in a different way. I completely agree with you.
But how does that work, Mark? Because, you know, you've not been able to move for 20 years without people banging on about having local engagement initiatives and this and that and the other at the local level. So is it... Are you saying it's
catastrophic reduction of funding of local authorities and local authority arts services? That's where all that work happened. Connected to local place through investment and a sense of purpose where local authorities drove that work. You go to local authorities across the country now, they have no arts services. They have no arts services at all. We have a too top-down, centralised way of trying to deliver this, which fails.
Can I just come back on that quickly? After the referendum vote, I went to Margate and visited the Turner Contemporary, which is a fantastic art gallery funded by the National Lottery and the local authority. They had an exhibition during the referendum campaign, which was about immigration. And it was a really fantastic artwork by Yinka Shonabari. There were a number of really interesting points that the artwork was trying to make about the value of immigration to the UK. But what was really interesting was that there was no mention of the most significant impact of the EU in that area, which is on the fishing industry. The fishing industry in the whole of Margate has been completely destroyed. And yet what the art sector was talking about in relation to the EU referendum campaign was immigration. And I think sometimes the art sector thinks that it's talking to people from working class communities, but it's not listening to the things that have affected them and that concern them. And that's what I mean. I don't think there is a lack of effort or attempt from the art sector to want to engage. I think there is a genuine desire to. But it's actually the art sector and parts of the Remain campaign that are more preoccupied with the fear of racism and xenophobia and immigration. There were other issues in the EU referendum debate, and I don't think the art sector really engaged with that.
Very quickly. I think there is an interesting point about... artists not really engaging with with Britain and the UK, and they seem to look further afield. And you know, why is that issue? You know, certainly George Orwell was not that kind of writer. If you look at the recent Booker Prize winners, all of them are novels set elsewhere. We just don't have that kind of engagement, that re-engagement between artists and writers and the citizens of the nation that we live in. So there is it's a big question. I'd like to kind of see what people think about that, because I think the person at the back, you know, said there is a disconnect. We don't hear those voices in art and literature anymore.
Joe, come back on.
Yeah, I just want to answer your point about the EU. You're absolutely right about the EU and hate speech and the other examples you gave. The point I was making was that, first, that we had a campaign that was to try and make the EU improve, because we'd repealed criminal defamation laws where most of the EU hasn't. So I agree with you, but now that we're going to be out of the EU, we're not going to be able to improve anything. The other point I made was about the European Court of Human Rights, which is part of the Council of Europe, as being a court that we can go to when we've run out of any options here with court cases, and it has led to some very, very key rulings. No, it's not. That's saying there's two separate points. I'm critical of the EU as well, which is why we had this campaign on criminal defamation. And the other point I wanted to just make about the arts is that cinema is part of the arts, and I'm sure the blobby people in Great Yarmouth like going to the cinema. Visual effects is part of the cinema. 25% of the people who work in the visual effects industry in this country come from the EU.
Okay, so can I see your hands? It's quite difficult to see. Right, God, loads of hands. Okay, so why don't we start down here and work our way back. Right at the front.
One thing that I wanted to pick up on is that right at the beginning we talked about opportunities, and also we talked about optimism. And for myself, I would like to hear your views to give me a sense of optimism for what the arts, how will the culture and arts in the UK benefit from leaving the EU? We've talked about being UK in the global world. I don't see how leaving Europe puts us more into being part of globalism. To me, we've not really addressed this evening about the reductionist attitudes that have been discussed, about the rhetoricism that we've heard in terms of talking about the UK only. What about the UK and the arts in the global world if we leave the EU?
Okay, so there's a microphone there. Yes, on you go. Can you take the microphone? Yes, to that guy there. Yeah,
so I'm quite aware that this discussion is quite focused on the arts world, but I'm really worried about the disappearance of lower classes from around the world from our discussion as a whole. So there is lower class, like blue collars in Britain that are part of discussion, and whether we should make connections to them. There is this kind of, protecting arts and artists, desirable policy about freedom of movement and so on of the artists and making connections around the world. But what about all the rest of the people and how this gets connected to two things? One thing is really kind of more and more capitalist orientation of the arts. The need for self-funding, the need for finding talents, the best of the best in the world. And on the other hand, the kind of issues of social justice and freedom.
Okay. We need to keep the points reasonably short. Can you just hand it to that lady back there? And yes.
Hi. I was just, this idea of what is an artist, you know. And I was kind of thinking that, for years, I've done a bit of this and a bit of that, and it's all been failed completely, and I kind of thought, what motivates me is that sense of not being popular and being ignored, you know. And I think if someone just gave me loads of money and said I was a great guy, I'd be like, I'd be lost, you know. So I'm thinking that this whole idea of the artist as some sort of special protected person. I mean, who tells you you're an artist? I don't know. But the other thing is, in terms of, to this point here, what is specific about artists? Because there's a whole visa system for people coming into the country for all kinds of jobs, chefs and engineers, and they all have to work for a company, and that company applies for visas. Is there something really specific about artists that makes them different from everybody else?
Okay, we'll come back to that. So, yes, and to that lady there.
Hi, I'm Mel Whelan from Spiked. Joe, it seems to me that you've criticised a lot about the EU and listed a big long list of things that you'd like to change about it, and it kind of makes me wonder what it is that many artists say they like about the EU, what many people in the creative industry seem to like about the EU, because really what I think was left at the heart of it when many people in the creative industry were saying they were for the EU was a kind of an emotional attachment, not to put it too crudely. And this was really summed up by, in my opinion, a really poor artist, Wolfgang Tillmans, whose posters were shared, I think, by almost everyone I know who works in the creative industry, every artist I know. And the kind of quotes that were shared on it is, "No man is an island, no country by itself. We are the European family. If people like Rupert Murdoch, Farage, Galloway, Griffin and Le Pen want Britain to leave the EU, where does that put you?" And so it seems that, I think, you know, a criticism that I think you really need to pick up on is, what is it that you do like about the EU? And is it this kind of, to my mind, sort of being in danger of an airy-fairy emotional attachment to it in terms of Europe as a family, as a kind of special, as a sharing zone? Because that's not very substantial at all.
Okay. Yes. Can you pass the microphone back to the guy in the white shirt?
I was just interested in what Sarah said about, she felt, or perhaps statistically knows, that she was the 4% of artists who were pro-Brexit against the 96% of the art community that were very strongly Remain. I just wondered how the panel reflected on that and what that means. And I heard your cry of the heart, Joe, in, you know, but what happens if you burn everything up and there are no rules, they're not civil servants, and, you know, we've had the path for 60 years to understand where we go, and now there is no path. And I guess once before, you'd always thought artists as the iconoclasts, that they were the outliers, they were the smasher-uppers of the rules. Has something happened to the arts community that it seems perhaps more conservative, in inverted commas? And has there been any reflection, do you feel, or any change in the arts world since Brexit to sort of, you know, has that moved, or is it still Sarah's the 4%? What reflection has been there, I think?
Okay, one more in this round, then I'll come back to the panel, and then we'll come out again. So, yes.
It's the Adam Rawcliffe Institute of Ideas. It built on a lot from the last question, actually. I wanted to just ask the panel if they think there's any opportunity for a post-Brexit moment in the arts, a burst in creativity. At the moment, we're reassessing everything. The government's going to bring in a new industrial strategy, which offers a massive amount of potential for us to control our own destiny and be creative, be ingenuous. I just want to ask if you think that there's any chance for that for the arts, rather than being bogged down in where the funding's going to come from, why we're still unsatisfied with the EU and the Brexit vote.
All right, I know there's lots of people still want to speak, but I'm going to come back to the panel. Just pick up one point quite quickly, if you can. Joe, do you want to start?
Yeah, no, just on emotional attachments. I think, obviously, I'm sure everybody in this room has emotional attachments to the EU, historical attachments, the Second World War, the story of your families, and so on. But the point is, from my perspective, it's not about emotional attachment at all. It's about, as I've tried to give a sense of, the very important institutions we have that protect our rights, that make it possible for society to flourish, for artists to do their work, and not just the artists, but for everybody else as well. And that leads into the question about artists as iconoclasts. You know, art isn't just the rebel in the attic doing his angry paintings. It's about, again, all the structures, the Lift Festival, the remarkable scheme that Mark's going to be working on in Manchester. It's about a whole symbiotic structure that goes across society and that needs all sorts of different shapes and institutions and protections to make it possible.
Okay, Sarah, direct question to you. Do you want to come back on that?
Yeah, sure. I think part of the problem is that is the idea that artistic freedom and control of the borders are mutually exclusive. Artistic freedom, by definition, is autonomous and already exists in a way that transcends borders. Artistic freedom does not demand, should not demand an imposition or coercion on the security of others or demand to undermine the law in order to be realized. In my view, artistic freedom and controls on immigration do not have to be mutually exclusive. They can be true at once. But in order for socially engaged practices to operate successfully through advocacy or political intervention, they call upon the notion of citizenship, which is what I feel has been hugely undermined in the discourse around the referendum.
Okay. Manik, do you want to pick up on any of that?
Reasonably
quickly.
Question around you know, the diversity of voices in amongst the arts community, and I think it's, you know, very brave for people, artists like Sarah, to kind of come out and come out as a Brexiteer, in a sense, because actually there is a highly antagonistic kind of feeling, and many artists that I know will not be vocal about it. They'll just be very quiet, and that is very sad, I think, because, you know, where you do feel that, you know, freedom of expression, of being able to recognise different points of views, and Sarah certainly has a very unique point of view compared to many other of my the artists that I know, but there are others, the kind of intolerance within the art sector actually does sideline many of those voices, and that's really worrying, I think, you know, in a kind of liberal, tolerant sector.
Mark, you don't have to pick up anything if you don't want to.
Just a couple of very quick points. I think the thing I like about the EU isn't an emotional attachment, it's that I can very easily bring together 15 directors of major institutions and do a deal with them very quickly around the table to invest in a new production, to support artists, to make interesting stuff happen. I genuinely do hope that the disruption of Brexit will unleash a new surge of creativity. I accept I was on the losing side. We have to make the best of this. We can't fight the idea that it's not going to happen. It is happening. You know, some of the most exciting art I experienced was growing up in the 80s under Margaret Thatcher. That was when artists had something to say about what was going on in the world, and maybe Brexit might unleash a bit of that, a bit of that creativity and add to the national debate. I hope that happens.
It was very hard for me during the campaign to see all these artists that I really love and admire saying things that I disagreed with politically, and not just saying things that I disagreed with, but characterising people like me in quite very negative terms. But, you know, c'est la vie, that's life. I do think it's true, you made the point in the audience about the emotional nature of this debate, and I think that it has clouded people's political judgment, and it's become a debate about rhetoric rather than reality. And that does have quite a chilling effect in the art sector, because people, and I have met many people for quiet confessional lunches who have admitted to me that they voted Brexit, but, you know, as Manik's experience as well, wouldn't say publicly. What does that say about our art sector? These people are afraid to speak to their peers, their colleagues in the art sector. You know, the sector that we say is all about challenging and provoking and is all at the vanguard of ideas, and yet there are people who feel that they can't have a reasoned, logical debate about the pros and cons of remaining in the EU. There are many people that I admire who wanted to remain in the EU, and I respect them. There were decent arguments on both sides. But the idea that people can't have this debate without fear of their reputation being damaged, I think it tells you something about the arts today.
Okay, thanks. So there's a huge number of people that still want to speak, so we've got about 10 minutes, because I do want to give them a little time to come back at the end, but if we can try and get as many people in as possible and keep the contributions very short. So there's a guy at the back there, right behind you.
Just a very quick point about the emotional attachment, and I think Joe actually inadvertently made the point, which is Europe is not the EU. we have attachments to Europe. I had my best night out in Paris. I had a second best night out in America. It doesn't make me attached to a particular political union. The attachment is Europe, and the attachment is European culture, European history. It is not the EU.
Okay. And the guy in the glasses?
Joe, I completely agree with you when you say that we should be really worried about the state of freedom of expression when it comes to the artist. But I'm gently going to disagree with you when you try to seek refuge in the European Court of Human Rights as if it's some bastion of free speech. When you look at Article 10, it says we're committed to freedom of speech, but you look at the amendments where it then talks about hate crimes, hate speech, then talks about how we shouldn't even allow some kind of expression that corrupts morals in society. I mean, if you've got that in there, I mean, you basically can't have Madame Bovary, you can't have Goethe. How is that promoting freedom of expression? I completely understand your aversion to the UK politics as well on the other side. So you look at the UK government and their prevent strategy, and under their kind of comments on hate speech, it won't even let that great cultural figure, Tyler the Creator, into the UK because he's allegedly promoting hate speech. But surely we would rather have a crap system that we can hold accountable than one that we can't.
Okay, can you hand it down there? And you...
Yeah, I want to make a point about what Mark said about working in Lagos. And he mentioned both the Goethe Institute and he mentioned the Institut Français. Now, in the old days, we had the British Council. And if we're going to go into this global situation, we're going to need a salesman. And actually, we've been doing exactly the opposite. We've been dismantling the British Council, and we really need to put an enormous amount of money behind that if we're going to market our art to the rest of the world.
Okay, the lady with the microphone, if you could hand it. Yeah, okay. And then to the lady behind.
Fantastically interesting debate, but I'm confused, and maybe you can help me out with my confusion. I'm mainly confused about borders, so I'm going to pick up quickly on what the three women on the panel said. Not because I don't care about you guys, but I'm setting up my own borders and we're short of time. I really felt for Sarah, and it's been touched on by Munira and Manik, when you said at the start you were fearful of your Arts Council funding if you fessed up to being a Brexit voter, and even worse, a Tory. I just think we all need to step back and think about the borders of the mind that have been created by arts bureaucracy in the country, when you should be held account, not how good or bad your art is, but you're fearful because of your political view. I think that's shocking in the 21st century in the UK. It's absolutely shocking. Joe, I admire the work that Penn does, but I'm slightly confused. I may be politically, legally naive here. If you really think the fight for criminal defamation is the right fight to have, why don't you just hop over the borders, work with partners in those countries and fight the fight if you truly believe that is the right thing? Munira, I've believed in open borders.
One.
I'll be quick. And I was interested and challenged by what you had to say. And you did say that it's not that it's never citizenship, but that you have to, a longer journey, that you have to earn the right to citizenship. And my fear about that is, for me, as a migrant who wants to strive, who believes not just in a better economic life for myself, but a better vision of me and we, society in the world, who decides? Who decides that I've earned it? Who has the authority? Where's that authority going to lie in this more fluid world of not open borders, for example? So can you just help me out there? Because it concerns me about who will decide.
Okay, and front.
Hi. I work for the British Council, and it is in no way dismantled. I work on international strategy for music, and I used to work in the music sector, in the commercial sector. I want to pick up on a few points, because I really agree that it's actually the small end of DIY artists. I think art will flourish, as it always has done, but it's the sector that's built around it, the institutions, the frameworks, the touring. I think it's really important to not gloss over some of the challenges that are about to ensue. And I also want to say that the creative industry are actually, in spite of the 96% figures, are rolling up their sleeves and wanting to make stuff happen. There are some opportunities, particularly in renegotiating deals around data, digital, copyright. But there is a huge amount of work, which actually means that people are going to spend the next few years focusing on renegotiating deals when they would have liked to have been looking further afield internationally. The big touring agencies, arena-sized tours, will not feel the bumpy terrain as much as emerging and upcoming artists who need to make their way internationally.
Okay, lady behind.
Thank you. I'm a writer who has no trouble in not justifying voting leave, but actually explaining why I voted leave. And two key facts about the EU is one is that every member state has a heavy austerity agenda and welfare cuts, and you try being an artist in a heavily welfare cut country. The other one is that many progressive policies, for example, some of Jeremy Corbyn's and renationalisation policies are actually illegal under EU law. And my third point is that people, and this is the art point, and the arts are shot full of this, is that people need a sense of agency over their own lives. And to give a brief anecdote, I phoned a relative who lives in a council house by one of the old rundown Scunthorpe steelworks, and everybody was out on voting morning, you know, dressed in their best, meeting up for lunch, tea, coffee, whatever, more ever than a general election. And that was a sense of people having some sort of control over their own future. And can I also question this idea of globalization?
No, we need to move on.
All right, sense of agency, we'll leave it there.
Thank you. So, yes.
Okay. Mark at the beginning said there wasn't enough talk about shared ideals, but there was. There was a lot of talk about democracy, which was, broadly speaking, dismissed by Remain voters as a sort of side issue or ignored altogether. But it is one of the foundational ideas that underlies many other rights we have. It was developed internationally, and it can be applied universally. So why are artists not that interested in that particular shared ideal? I think your view of democracy says a lot about what you think of people. So are artists just not that interested in people?
Okay, the lady next to you. And yes, go on.
I certainly think the point about working class people being excluded from the arts is definitely true, and that's like been an issue like long, long before Brexit. I just wondered, like, now that Brexit has happened, like you're saying about this, like, bureaucracy that's, and I definitely think that it's not just the bureaucracy; it's like the whole image of that art has is just like something for middle class people. And I just wondered, like, is there anything that's being set up to kind of help that? Like, are there any groups being set up to, like, sort of to do something about that? Because, like, and where is, and if we're not going to have the EU, like, where are we going to get the funding from?
Okay,
because it sounds like a good idea.
Okay, thank you. There's been loads of hands. I'm not going to be able to get everyone in because we've got to come to bring this to an end. But yes, you've got the microphone. Go.
Right.
Last one.
Sorry, David Axe from Invoke Democracy Now. I was really struck, actually, by something the lady in front of me said about our artists closing themselves off from blue-collar workers, from ordinary people. And I think that's definitely true. There's a lot of talk about openness. I mean, God knows how many times I've heard the word openness used throughout this, whereas actually it's closure. It's closing, kind of a political closure against ordinary people. And I think that's taking the form of characterising their vote to leave the EU as a racist, anti-immigrant vote, when the evidence says otherwise. You know, the Ashcroft poll says that sovereignty was at the top of ordinary people's agenda when they voted to leave the EU. Even the EU's own Searchlight survey says that there's been an increase in approval for EU and non-EU immigrants in this country. You know, the way that people's voting decision has been described really is a misrepresentation.
Okay, thank you very much. So, should we just go in the same order as we started? So, Joe.
Yeah, there's a question about the European courts. But the issue is this, that it is the highest court that we can go to protect the right to freedom of expression and other rights. And it has often given that protection when the courts in this country can't. And what I'm very afraid of is Theresa May fulfilling her plan to withdraw from the Council of Europe, withdraw from the court, withdraw from the convention, and bring in a Bill of Rights that suits her political purposes. In terms of criminal defamation, I'd love to hop over the border, but I am a British citizen, so the only way that I can campaign in the EU Parliament around criminal defamation is if we're a member of the EU.
Sarah, any final thoughts?
Sure. In response to the questions about artists not being able to express their opinions or the arts not serving as a centre for dissensus in which majority of the views that are expressed are all along the same lines, I absolutely agree. I think that it is very ironic that the arts have come to serve as a mouthpiece for the mainstream media, when really artists should be posing difficult questions to what is the received wisdom. In terms of the question that was raised by the lady in the back, I think that part of the problem is that nationhood and citizenship is perceived as the preoccupation of the far right. I remember in 2014 when Paul Cummins made the artwork at the Tower of London with the poppies, there was a review in The Guardian in which Jonathan Jones said, well, the Tower of London poppies are fake, they're trite and inward-looking. It's a UKIP-style memorial. It's disturbing that we can only mark this war as a nationalistic tragedy. It evokes an inward-looking mood that lets UKIP thrive. I think it is so sad that we see nationalism as something that is reduced to race as opposed to ideology and what we believe in.
Okay, that's perfect place to leave it, I think. Manik, your final thoughts.
One question that I have, which Mark mentioned about, you know, our export to Europe and very kind of well-known theatre companies going across the borders. But what I find interesting is that, you know, the idea, notion of European theatre, Andrew Hayden, the theatre critic, said that European theatre is still foreign to us. And how many contemporary European plays do we actually see on our stages here? Because we don't define the idea of Europe as some kind of identity. You know, it's French, it's German, Belgian, you know, it's Dutch. And so it's not about being anti-Europe, it's about recognising the kind of rich and varied culture that exists within the continent of Europe and beyond the continent of Europe through our Commonwealth relationships and those kind of Francophone countries, etc., etc. So we really do need to kind of extend those narratives further. Coming back, I really do feel there's a lack of a kind of modern-day George Orwell in British thinking, in British arts, in British culture, and we do need to kind of ask ourselves big existential questions: to why are there no really exciting writers writing about contemporary Britain compared to, say, the 80s, where we had some fantastic theatre writers writing about the towns in Manchester. And so forth, but we just don't get that now. So, and maybe that's a result of this kind of belittling of Britain and a British outlook around the citizens that we all kind of know and live with. So, that's the kind of question I'd like to ask artists: why are you not making work about Britain?
This is a debate which is typified by absolute certainties on both sides. And that's a real problem. Europe, globalism, racism, tolerance. And the thing which I think ultimately makes me a bit optimistic is that, what artists are really great at doing is exploring ambiguity and not exploring certainties. Art that explores certainty is pretty crap art often. Art which explores ambiguity is where you find the way through. And actually, it's probably in the ambiguity between those fixed certainties that we will find a way through this. And maybe, you know, I do wish that hopefully it won't happen, of course, that, you know, that Theresa May and David Davis's negotiation team might be populated by a couple of artists. Put Grayson Perry around the table and, you know, that might be an interesting opportunity. But I think that artists have a role in trying to, on both sides, I'm guilty of it, I know, on both sides, in trying to break down that sense of stubborn certainty that we have about this, because that's not going to get us anywhere. But artists who have that insight will.
Okay, thanks, Mark. And Venera.
Yeah, I was asked a specific question about citizenship. I mean, I think there are
There are standard ways in which you can objectively measure the pathway to citizenship, which is usually based on the years that a person has been living in a country. And that is, as I understand it, the system for non-EU people in this country. And I think we probably need to revise the whole system, but it should be fair for people outside the EU as well as inside the EU. It is worth just making the point that there are lots of Europeans who also would like to leave the EU. You know, it's not just a few right-wing Tories who concocted this whole thing. And there are, interestingly, in Europe, left-wing people who would like to leave the EU. It's a peculiarity of UK politics that the left... Yeah, well, Jeremy Corbyn, Tony Benn, who was famously in favour of leaving the EU and campaigned against the first referendum in joining, because he recognised that actually there are many left-wing arguments against the EU, and many of those have come to transpire. There are very legitimate arguments about free movement being a way of managing the economic crisis, the fallout in the southern Mediterranean countries. The fact that we have so many Spanish-trained doctors in the UK is actually not great for the Spanish system. Right? So these are the kinds of questions that I think we should be debating, and there are pros and cons on both sides. What I would like the art sector to do is to move away from the emotion and the rhetoric and the name-calling and to engage with some of these serious political arguments and recognise that it is much more complex than you want to leave the EU, you want to leave Europe, you hate Europeans and you hate the world. And I think that's what's happened in this debate.
Okay, can we thank them all, please? We'll be right back.